Well, hello, beaters. I'm Ann Benson, and I'd like to introduce you to my new and, I think, improved beading and tapestry loom. This baby's been a long time coming because there were a number of design and manufacturing issues that needed to be resolved. My goal was to produce an affordable, portable, easy-to-use loom specifically for bead weaving, but with qualities and characteristics that work for small fiber tapestry as well. You can use this loom for beads alone, for fibers alone, or in combination. This tabletop loom is slanted for neck comfort and has an open construction so you can easily reach under your work. You can create a nice working tension in your warp by adjusting the position of the outer comb. And when the warp is fully in place, there are covers to prevent slippage and to minimize thread snagging. The loom includes pronged, two-sided combs with different spacing, one side sized roughly for 11-0 seed beads and size 11 cylinder beads, which are quite close in size, and the other sized roughly for 15-0 seed beads. I say roughly because there are natural size variations based on the manufacturer and on the kind of finish on the bead. These combs are held in place by two sets of end stands, one taller for the end of the loom facing away from you, and one set shorter for the end closer to you. These end stands are connected with two stainless steel threaded rods and secured vertically with crossbars. The combs and comb covers are printed in PLA plastic on a 3D printer. It takes about 6 hours for each set. The end stands and crossbars are fabricated on a computer-guided router using PVC. That process takes about an hour. Wing nuts and hex nuts keep the end stands in position. Once your warp is in place, two covers keep the threads in place and prevent thread snagging. End caps cover the ends of the rods. And as you weave, you'll need to beat down or compress your work. The first step in assembly is to thread two wing nuts onto each of the two threaded rods, with the wings facing inward toward each other. Bring them in about 3 inches on both ends. Slip the short end stands onto the rods with the curve facing inward. Slip a hex nut onto the rod outside the end stand so there are just a couple of threads visible on the rod end. Adjust the stands to touch the hex nuts, then tighten the wing nuts to hold the end stands in place. I suggest aligning the wings on the wing nuts vertically, which will minimize catching your thread as you weave. It's very unlikely that you'll be adjusting the position of the short stands, so the nuts can be well tightened. You might need to use one of your beading pliers for this. Put the taller stands on the other ends, again with the curves facing inward. Use the two remaining wing nuts to secure the taller ends in place. All your sizing adjustments will be made on this end, so just tighten them enough to hold the stands in place. Rotate all four of the stands to vertical and slip the crossbars into the slots. The fit will be tight. Press them all the way in. Decide which side of the prongs you want to face upward, then insert the combs into the slots accordingly. The fit will and should be tight. You're now ready to size your project and warp the loom. The maximum weaving area is 11 inches by 6¾ inches. If you're not an experienced beader or weaver, I'd suggest starting with a project no more than 3 inches wide. The tendency in warping is to pull more tightly in the center area of the warp span than on the outer edges. Try to resist doing this. Don't worry if the warp is not fully tight, as you'll be able to tighten it later. Keep all the warp thread, outer and inner, equally stretched. The end stands will be adjusted as part of the sizing. Tensioning the warp is part of this process as well. You're likely to move the end stand outward by a half inch to get the warp nice and tight, so you should initially warp the loom a little bit shorter than what you want. I say a little bit, even though you may move the taller end stand out what will seem like more than a little bit. But when you take the finished piece off the loom, it will contract slightly. Sizing is really a trial and error operation. You might try a couple of small practice pieces before engaging in your masterpiece. Secure the end of your warp in one of the holes in the crossbar on the shorter end stands. A longer warp thread tail might come in handy later, so you can wind the warp around the crossbar a few times before bringing it to the prongs if you want to. Bring the thread up at what will be one of the outer edges of your piece. Run the threads back and forth between the combs, wrapping the thread around the prong. I find it helps to hold the thread in place with my thumb on the back of the comb before going in the opposite direction. You can slide the comb covers in place as you progress to keep the growing warp intact. To adjust the taller ends for tensioning, unwind the outer wing nuts 2 or 3 rotations, the same number on both sides. Push out the end stands and wind the inner wing nuts closer to secure them. Do this as many times as needed until you're satisfied with the tension on your warp. At that time, tightly secure the wing nuts. I like to use a bit of masking tape or an elastic band to secure the comb covers. I couldn't make them so tight that they rubbed on the warp, so there may be a bit of play. There you have it. I hope you will enjoy this versatile tool. I've put a lot of thought and time and not a small amount of trial and error into its development. Now it's up to you. This is Ann Benson. Thanks for joining me, and please join me again soon.